Cloud computing is a confusing term. It's sometimes used to describe the entire internet itself, but at its core, it's the idea of running some sort of service from someone else's computer. Imagine you've started a new website. To get that website online and allow for other people to access it, you have to host it somehow. You could create your own server at home by installing web server software on your own computer. That will allow for it to listen to incoming requests and respond to clients with the files that make your website. But you may see the problem here. You won't really be able to use your computer if your website's under heavy load, and you'll also have to ask your mom to never turn off the internet ever again. Of course, this isn't too practical, which brings us onto modern cloud computing. Instead of worrying about keeping your computer online, pay someone else to do it for you instead and use their computers. Also, don't worry about replacing components. If something dies, it's up to them to fix it. It's hard to say where the cloud first originated, as early computers were basically a set of terminals in one room that people used to send commands into the computer next door, which sort of fits our definition of running a service on someone else's computer. But when we're talking about the modern cloud, we can probably trace its origins back to the early noughties. Before Jeff Bezos was building phallic-shaped rockets to take him to space, he needed a way for Amazon developers to spend more time on actual work instead of general maintenance tasks. He got together a team and asked them to develop a set of products that could be used to make building apps and systems for Amazon quicker. The first service they developed was called SQS, a message queue system, first used by Amazon themselves in their packing centers. This was released as a public beta in 2004 and fell under the newly created Amazon Web Services. In 2006, they launched a handful of other services, and these services focus on allowing you to build all the necessary infrastructure to run your website, backend, game, without ever having to touch an actual server ever again physically. The main release here being EC2, Elastic Compute Cloud, and this service allows you to log into AWS, click on a few buttons, and provision a server. There are now dozens of big players with thousands of services between them. Though at their core, they all offer the same services to provision servers and help you get your app online. Nowadays, the big three players are Amazon's AWS, Microsoft's Azure, and Google's cloud platform, eating up well over half the cloud market share. Cloud undoubtedly has developed at an absolutely rapid pace over the last few years, but if I were to boil it down to what the key to the cloud's rapid takeover and success is, it would be the fact that the providers have continued to chase the abstraction dragon, pushing convenience for developers to the absolute limit. The amount of convenience can be categorized into three main layers of abstraction, the first of these being infrastructure as a service. Like I said earlier, you need some sort of infrastructure to host your website, and this is exactly what all cloud platforms are going to be able to provide. You log in, select the amount of cores in your CPU, the amount of RAM and storage that you need, and that's it, you have a server that you can log into. Only the infrastructure is being provided to you as a service, however, and it's down to you to configure the servers yourself. This is the professional equivalent of your friend letting you log into their Raspberry Pi to do what you want with it. But what happens if you've created your website locally on your own computer, but don't know how to set up a web server? Well, that's where platform as a service comes in. The cloud provider will give you a platform to run your code in, and all you need to do is configure the amount of processing power that you want to throw at running your application. The downside to this is that platform as a service is expensive, as you're paying for a computer to be on 24/7, as well as for the luxury of having the configuration managed for you. Examples of PaaS services are Google's cloud platform and Amazon's Elastic Beanstalk. If you fancy another comparison, think of giving a memory stick to your mate with your website files on it, then they go home and set up the website for you and provide you with a link later on to use. Okay, so listen up, since this is where it starts to get really exciting. Think of the convenience of PaaS, but without having to pay for the cost of a server to be up all the time. Let me introduce you to Serverless. But what the f*** does that mean? This is a weird one. When I first heard it, I was completely baffled. How can you run an app without a server? Surely there needs to be some sort of computer somewhere, right? Well, yeah, that's true. The server is still there, but the idea is that you run your code on a configured platform, but you only pay for the time you use, not for the time you don't. So if your website only has 10 minutes of traffic in a day, you only pay for 10 minutes of a server being online, not the entire day. To achieve this, we reach a level of abstraction where each individual component that makes up a website is its own separate service that only charges you for the time that you use that particular service. The pattern that might start to emerge is this. We need something to send HTML, CSS, and JavaScript files to a browser. We need something to process requests that can't be processed from the browser, such as checking a username and password for authentication. And we need some sort of data storage. So if we can find the services that can do each of these things for us, we can combine them together and create a complete serverless application. You can host your files in Dropbox or GitHub, and with a few clicks, ask Dropbox or GitHub to serve your directory or repo as a website. More commonly though, you'll use services such as AWS's S3 or Azure's storage to host your front-end website files. To set up the backend, we can use services such as AWS's Lambda or Azure or GCP's Cloud Functions. These services allow you to give them some code to run, then provide you with an endpoint. Once you trigger this endpoint, it will trigger your code, and this is most commonly used to build REST APIs, which is essentially a fancy term to build an app that runs some code on your server when a user hits a specific endpoint of a URL. When it comes to long-term storage, there are products out there for both SQL and NoSQL databases, such as Amazon's Relational Database Service or DynamoDB. Other cloud providers also offer similar products, and every cloud provider out there will likely offer some form of hosted database service. Bringing these services together allows you to serve your website files, backend requests, and have a place to store your data without ever having to configure a single server, think much about resources, and only pay for the time your users actually use your site. Not really a category of the layers of abstraction I mentioned earlier, but I wanted to finish off by talking about software as a service, also known as SaaS. This is a very broad term and encompasses pretty much any service or application that you may interact with online. Popular examples of this are Google Drive, Adobe Cloud, accountancy software, and content management systems. It's common nowadays as well to hear this as a service postfix on all kinds of new services. Uber is transport as a service, Netflix is film and TV streaming as a service, BetterHelp is therapy as a service, and the sponsor for today's video is... no one, we don't have a sponsor on my channel with 100 subs, like, come on, man. Although I do want to give a massive shout out to everyone who subscribed so far. My goal was to get 100 subs by the end of the year, but we managed to do it with a month to spare. Much love, thanks for watching.